Let your life testify. Let your life testify. Let your life testify.
God, we worship you. Father, we adore you. Father, we claim that we're nothing without you, God. So we ask that you would breathe into us, Lord, the breath of life, that we might know you better this day than we knew you before. God, I pray that you would continue into this moment, Lord God, and breathe upon me, Father, that I might not be seen or heard, but only you, Lord God. Speak into our hearts, Lord, that we all might hear the word, but become doers of the word. And we thank you for all of these things, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Grab your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. And once you found Ephesians chapter 4, I ask that you would please stand to honor the reading of God's word this morning. Ephesians 4, starting at verse 17. My version might be a little bit different, but it says, "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." The word of the Lord. You may be seated. For the last week, the week before April vacation, I was in Orlando, Florida with the DeVos Urban Leadership Initiative. And DeVos is an amazing training program that emphasizes the empowerment and development of those serving young people all over the United States. Throughout the week, we heard a number of speakers, some pastors, but most alumni of the program, who shared of their personal stories and experiences. All very honest, all very transparent, but one of the most inspiring and touching moments for me was to meet Mr. and Mrs. DeVos. The DeVoses are millionaires, easily. They are owners of the Orlando Magic. They have several businesses, one of which is a multi-city sports and wellness complex that houses everything from ice hockey and basketball to dental offices and mental health services. The DeVoses give away millions of dollars each year to charitable donations, and even for our training program, no participants had to pay for anything from airfare to lodging, books, or materials. But with all of these accolades and all the accomplishments, with all their money and assets, our group sat with them and asked them what they wanted to be remembered for, what would be the greatest aspect of their legacy. And with a smile on his face, Mr. DeVos, almost 90 years old, stated that he wanted to be known for his faith in Christ. This wasn't a cliche statement. This wasn't him just wanting to say something nice for us to hear, he meant it. He told stories of giving Bibles to the players on the Orlando Magic, and we heard firsthand of his employees how much his faith and his prayers had changed their lives. Mr. DeVos was a man forever changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ, and not only did it transform him, but it transformed all those around him. As I left that meeting that night, I went back to my hotel room, and the question lingered in my mind, am I living my life every day as a reflection of the gospel? Am I living in light of the knowledge of Christ, and do my actions line up with my faith? These are tough, introspective questions that we must ask ourselves, because if we go out to the street or you walk through a high school or college campus and you ask people why they choose not to come to church, one of the consistent responses you'd hear is that they don't see a difference between us and them. This is what the writer Paul was talking about when we read his letter to Ephesians. Paul is writing to the church of Ephesus from prison, but unlike many other letters that he'd written, this one seems to be to a much broader audience. And in Ephesians chapter 1 through chapter 3, Paul declares the supremacy of Christ. It speaks of his amazing glory and splendor and focuses our attention on the spiritual blessings in heavenly realms. Paul exhorts and worships God and basks in the glory of the mystery of the gospel. In other words, Paul spends three whole chapters explaining the glorious details of all that Christ has done for us. And then we get to chapter 4, and Paul is ready to tell us how we should respond in light of it. In order to do this, Paul gives us a snapshot of what our lives should not look like. And again, I just want to emphasize that Paul is not writing to a group of non-believers or even to new converts. Paul is writing to one of the most sophisticated, one of the most well-taught body of believers in the Asian province. Paul has spent about 3 years himself personally teaching to the church of Ephesus, and then Apollos spent time there, and then Paul sent Timothy there. Well, what is my point? It is that if this letter was valid to them, then you can nudge your neighbor and say, well, we better pay attention too. You gotta actually nudge your neighbor and tell them you better pay attention too. Paul urges them not as a kind suggestion, but more as a stern father. You must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of your minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. In other words, Paul writes about how believers should not walk or navigate life in the way they used to, and he describes them as Gentiles. Can I just take a few seconds to teach this just a little bit?
Yes.
The Gentiles was a generic term for those who were considered opposite of a Jew, or in layman's terms, it would mean saved or unsaved, sinners and saints, godly versus ungodly. Do not walk like the ungodly, those who don't know Jesus. Their minds are confused. They are like blind men or those who walk around in the dark and who can see nothing. There is no real wisdom in their minds, and their thoughts were evil and self-seeking. That is how it was in Greece and in Rome, and that is how it is in our world today. Paul says they do not know about the life that God gives. Their minds are confused. Many people do not know God and have no real purpose in life. They don't plan out their lives well. And although this does not apply, no, to all people, this is how their lives will develop, not knowing God. It goes on to say that they refuse to listen to him. These people are separated from God because they have no knowledge of him. They choose to separate themselves from God, who alone gives us life. The spirits and minds of the Gentiles have become like hard stones. They do many things that are wrong, but they are not even ashamed. So they do all kinds of wicked things, and they become even worse. They have no shame for their evil ways, and they are not sad about it. Wrong thoughts in their minds lead to wrong desires, and wrong desires to sinful actions. They do not even care about the effect their actions have on other people's, nor do they care about what you or I think about their sin. They put everything that they have into their evil action, and it is like their business or their trade. They put all their time and energy into it, and they're greedy for it. They want more and more of it, and will stop at nothing to please their fleshly desires. In other versions, the term licentiousness is there, and it is used, a theologian by the name of Barclay elaborates on this term, which in the Greek means aselgia. And the great characteristic of this word is that the bad man will usually try to hide his sin, but the man who has aselgia, or licentiousness, in their hearts and their souls does not care how much he shocks the public opinion, so long as he can gratify his desires. I know sometimes as Christians we can count ourselves out of this equation. We will say, oh, well, thank God, that's not me. I'm at least sorrowful about my sin a little bit. I mean, I'm not proud of what I do, I just do it. So I found this amazing illustration for us that I believe captures the heart of what Paul is saying. I want to introduce you to Oscar the Grouch. Created in the late 60s, Oscar is one of the characters of Sesame Street who was created as the antithesis to the other personalities on the show. Unlike Big Bird and his helpfulness, or Elmo and his bright, cheery attitude, Oscar is a hateful jerk that conveniently resides in a trash can. His disheveled and impoverished look was intended to connect him with the rest of America who've been beaten down by life, and give voice to those whose days are not always sunny and bright. Oscar was the epitome of a grouch and has a sincere affinity for trash. In fact, there's a song that he wrote, and it says, oh, I love trash. Anything dirty or dingy or dusty, anything ragged or rotten or rusty, yes, I love trash. I have here a sneaker that's tattered and worn. It's full of holes and laces are torn. A gift from my mother since the day I was born. Yes, I love it because it's trash. I have here a newspaper 13 months old. I wrapped fish inside it. It's smelly and cold, but I wouldn't trade it for a big pot of gold. I love it because it's trash. I have a clock that won't work, a telephone, and an old telephone, a broken umbrella, and a rusty trombone. And I'm delighted to call them all my own. I love them because they're trash. Oh, how I love trash. Anything dirty or dingy or dusty, anything ragged or rotten or rusty. Yes, I love, oh, how I love. Yes, I love trash. Oscar, like many of us, had become a product of his environment. And the things that were meant to be temporarily a part of his life had become permanent staples. And instead of being disgusted by the mess in his life, he became infatuated with it. And just like the Gentiles, Oscar just couldn't get enough of his trash. He gave in to his fleshly desires and lived a life in total isolation from those around him. Well, one day, Big Bird called the crew together. He met with Cookie Monster and Elmo and Bert, and they decided to be a blessing to Oscar. They all pitched in and bought Oscar a house, and Oscar was amped. I mean, I have a house now. What an amazing opportunity to begin again. How great this will be to spread out and try something new. But if you look at the picture on the screen, can someone tell me where Oscar is in that house? If you look real closely, Oscar is in the trash can. Oscar is a picture of every believer who has professed Christ and gotten excited about 2 Corinthians 5:17, which told us that old things are passed away and behold, all things are now new. We've gotten excited about God's grace that's able to abound towards us and his willingness to do exceedingly, abundantly above all we could ever ask or think. We join the church and we sang in the choir. We read our Bibles every once in a while. But if you visit us on Monday or Tuesday, if you visit us at our jobs or in our homes, if you visit us in the midnight hours when the ends are not really meeting well, we, like Oscar, can be found right back in the trash cans. Big house all around us, but comfortable in the trash can. God blessing all around us, but in love with our mess. God promises abounding, people getting blessed, growing and prospering, coming to church but not feeling what everybody else is feeling. Trying to pray but losing focus, trying to maintain holiness and purity. But if we were honest with ourselves and before God, we'd confess that sometimes we revert back to the comfort of our trash cans, to the futility of our minds, and to the hardness of our hearts. And Paul says, wait a minute. But wait a minute, that's not what you learned. That's not how you learned Christ. What do you mean, Paul? This is the only place where you'll find the verb learn directly beside a person with no preposition. There's no missing about or of. It says that's not how you learned Christ. The Ephesians learned Christ not only learning about Jesus, but learning him. This means that a living, abiding knowledge of Jesus will keep us from the kind of sinful conduct that Paul is speaking of. Just knowing about Jesus is not enough to keep us pure. It's one thing to know about Christ being a healer, but when you know him as a healer yourself, it becomes a little bit more real. It's one thing to know of a Savior, but when you know, you can look back over the course of your life and recall the trash can that almost engulfed you, when you can consider the times you were sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. There was a master of the sea that heard your despairing cry, and from the trash he lifted me. And now, safe am I. Have you learned Christ? Have you walked with him for a little while? Has he met you in your midnight hour? Oh, this is where I get excited, Sister Joanne, because I've tried him and I know him. I know he's a way maker. I know he's a solid rock on which I can stand. I know he's my justifier. I know his grace is amazing and his mercy is everlasting. He's my redeemer and healer. He's my provider and friend. He's my heart fixer and my mind regulator, my bridge over troubled waters. He's my all in all. And just like the choir sang, he's real, for I can feel him in my soul. I heard about him, but more importantly, I've learned him for myself. And the more you know, the more you experience him, the more you try him, the more you want to please him. Charles Spurgeon says, if you want to know the Lord Jesus Christ, you must live with him. First, he must himself speak to you, and afterwards, you must abide in him. He must be the choice companion of your morning hours. He must be with you throughout the day, and you with him at the close of the night. And as often as you wake during your nights, you must say, when I awake, I am still with thee. A deep, intimate, personal relationship with Jesus should cause us to act in a way that reflects our deeper heart knowledge of him. Well, that's great and all, Paul, but Paul doesn't stop there. He proceeds to give us very practical insight on how to make this real in our lives. Verse 22, Paul tells us to put off the old self. Tell your neighbor, take it off.
Take it off.
To put off your old self is to continually, daily commit to die to your fleshly desires and the thing you may want, but you know that will not satisfy beyond the moment. Fundamentally, Paul says that for the Christian, there must be a breaking point with our past. Jesus isn't merely added to our old life. The old life must die, and he becomes our new life. There's a story of a painter who wanted to paint an old bench. He had worked all day, and he was tired. So instead of sanding down the wood first, he decided to paint over top of the old structure. It was not long before normal wear and tear exposed the old chips and the old imperfections that were simply covered up by new paint. Let me encourage you that no matter how tired you are, taking off the old self is imperative and foundational to our growth as believers. Not taking the time to intentionally take off the old self is how we, like Oscar, end back in the trash can. Or like that bench that was simply covered up, only masked what needed to be destroyed. This is why, Reverend Liz, the world doesn't see the difference in us. This is why the church is made a mockery of and foolishness prevails, because instead of putting off the old self, we simply paint over top of it. Colossians chapter 3 tells us in more vivid language to put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. And then it lists sexual immorality, impurity, passions, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. And those you once walked when you were living in them, but now you must put them away. Paul then moves on to verse 23, and he tells us to be renewed in the spirit of our minds. This isn't the first time we've heard this notion. Romans 12 talks about, similarly, not to be conformed to the patterns of this world, which is more walking in the way that the Gentiles walk. But to be transformed, there should be something different about you and I by the renewing of our minds. Renewing our minds means we have to stop thinking the old way. That's the way you used to live before you became a Christian. This is so that you can learn to think in a completely new way. Your mind was dead and it has become alive again. It should continue to become alive every day and every moment. Your mind was darkened. That's what went wrong in the first place. But now you have the Spirit of God in you. So you think in new ways. This leads to new life. But one insight that I've gained just from reading all about this is that our minds and our hearts are closely connected. And just like earlier, it was said that their ignorance or lack of knowledge or understanding is what led to the hardening of their hearts. In the same way, it is the renewing of our minds that regenerates and softens our hearts towards God again. If you find yourself in a place where your heart seems to be turned away from God, I would encourage you to check your thought life. What thoughts, attitudes, preconceived notions are you entertaining? The Bible says to cast down every imagination, every thought that exalts itself above the knowledge of Christ. But again, that is our responsibility. We must hold our thoughts captive and filter them through the context of our knowledge of Christ, because unguarded thoughts will yield an unguarded heart. Lastly, Paul says in verse 24, he tells us to put on the new self, which is made in the likeness of God. God created Adam and Eve, and he made them perfect, and he gave them his own nature. It is a nature of true goodness and holy ways. God was close to them all the time. He walked with them and he talked with them, but their sin caused everything to go wrong. They lost this close relationship and they lost God's nature, causing us to be born into sin with innate desires to rebel against God. This is why you don't have to teach a baby to be greedy or to act up. It just happens. But now God has given that relationship back to us. This is based on Christ who died for us on the cross. It is because of his finished work of the cross that we have access to a new birth. By his death, men and women can be born again. God has given us a relationship with himself, and it is now as it was when he first created Adam and Eve. Jesus' death made it right so that we can have new life. This new nature is the new creation of God. It is the act of God alone. You can't create it yourself. It's nothing you can conjure up or make. It is the new birth from God alone. And just like you can't give yourself a physical birth, nor can you give yourself a spiritual rebirth. You have now to leave your old person behind. You must therefore leave the old kind of behaviors with your renewed minds and put on or clothe yourself in a way that reflects the holiness and righteousness of God. It's interesting to me that the world indicates that what you do determines who you are. But the gospel, God's way of thinking, says that who you are should determine what you do. God wants us to bring forth fruit that is consistent with our repentance. In other words, God wants us to act and respond to life in a way that is consistent with what we believe. I stop by only to encourage and admonish us all this morning to put off the old self, which leads to destruction. Continuously be in the process of renewing your minds. And you can do that by coming to church, yes, but you need a personal relationship with Jesus. You need to be reading your Bible. You need to be spending time in prayer at your house, because we renew our minds by infiltrating it with God thoughts. And then we put on the new self. So when people look at you, yes, on Sundays at church, and yes, on the prayer line, but in your everyday life, in the good and the bad, at your best and at your worst, when the kids are behaving and when they're going crazy, in all circumstances, they see Jesus in and through you. Let us pray. God, we are convicted by your word that reminds us and encourages us not to walk in the way that we used to. And that term walk is not just a simple suggestion, but it talks about the everyday, every way situation in which we navigate life. And I know that sometimes, God, it's easier to revert back to that trash can. God, sometimes it's easier to go back to what was familiar, what was comfortable. God, but I believe that you're pushing us here in this body to walk out our faith in a way that is meaningful, in a way that is challenging, in a way that causes us to respond to life a bit differently. And so, God, we come before you this morning asking that you would transform our hearts.
Your gifts just tangle in the dirt. Nah, yeah. Use what you got to edify the church.